Welcome everybody, this is Nick Timmers and this is Albert Spruit, and we are here to present Bypassing Secure Boot using Fault Injection. This talk will be a composition of different topics related to bypassing secure boot using Fault Injection. We will start off with introductions to both Fault Injection and Secure Boot, after which we will move on to the juice of this talk, which is the bypasses themselves. We will touch upon mitigations, how to overcome certain practicalities, and during the talk there will be two demos to support our message. First off, we are security analysts at Riskier, where we test the security of different products and technologies. And at Riskier, most people have a background in hardware security, software security, or crypto. And we use this background to test the security of embedded systems and smart cards. And in-house, we develop tooling that can be used to perform fault injection or side channel analysis. And in essence, at Riskier, we combine services and tools for fun and profit. And this presentation will give an overview of some of the research we've done the last 5 years. First off, to start with, when we talk about fault injection, we talk about introducing faults externally into a target to alter its intended behavior. For example, if we look at this little code snippet, we see that this code snippet is used to open a door or not, based on the fact if the key is correct or not. So using fault injection, we can change the intended behavior of this conditional if statement in order to open the door with the incorrect key. But this makes you wonder, how can we introduce such faults into the system that this happens? There are different types of fault injection techniques, all of which has been studied in the academic world extensively. And if you want more information about the characteristics of these techniques, I would like to refer you to some papers. One thing to realize is that all these techniques, they inject a glitch externally into the system, which causes a fault in the system. The only fault injection technique I would like to emphasize on is the fault injection technique that we will also demonstrate here on stage today, which is voltage fault injection. And basically this works by providing your own voltage to the target and pulling down the voltage at the right moment in order to change the intended behavior. And if you do this not too soft and not too hard, right in the middle on the so-called sweet spot, you change the behavior of the target at the specific moment in time without affecting the rest of the system. So the right moment in time would be, for example, when the key, the correctness of the key is verified. Using fault injection, we can actually generate different types of faults, and we like to classify these in two different groups. One group being the faults that affect hardware, and one group being the faults that affect hardware that does software. For example, in the first group, you can think of modifying register values or modifying data while it's in transit over internal dedicated buses. The second group is really targeting the subsystem responsible for executing software. So you can think of instructions getting corrupted or data handled by these instructions getting corrupted. And one thing to realize is that the subsystem to execute software is very complex. And it's very difficult to actually predict or even prove what exactly goes wrong, because you have only limited access to what's going on within that subsystem. And such a subsystem is, for example, an ARM core or a MIPS core. So what we do at Riskier when we are presented by code and we do not know what the robustness of the target is, we fall back to a very simple fault model for us, and that's instruction corruption. And basically that works like this. If we look at this MIPS instruction, we see that if we can flip one bit in the instructions encoding using fault injection, we will not add 8 to the register in T1, but we would add 0 to the register in T1. And effectively this also means that we actually are skipping the original instruction, because there's no side effect executing this instruction other than not executing the original instruction. More complex variants are possible as well, where actually multiple bits are being corrupted. For example, if we look at this ARM instruction, we see that we are not executing a load instruction anymore, but it's actually turned into a store instruction. One thing to realize is, if this is the fault model for a specific target, then it's unlikely you have very specific control over what bits you're going to flip. This can happen arbitrarily. Another thing to realize is that this may not even be the actual fault model of this target. However, what this fault model allows us to do is actually also covering the fault model of the behavior of other fault models. For example, we can also think of instruction skipping, data corruption. They will be somehow also reflected in instruction corruption. So that was the introduction to fault injection. I would like to move on to secure boot. So let's say we have a generic embedded system, which is composed of a chip that has functionality within. So there's a subsystem that's, that can process software, so the CPU, and it has some internal memories which are used for different purposes. There's two external components. So there's a non-volatile storage, the flash, to house the software when the device is off. And there's the DDR, which is a volatile storage in order to execute the software during boot. So once you power on this system, you'll see that the first stage bootloader, BL1.1, is loaded into internal SRAM, which is then executed from there, and which will actually set up the DDR and copies the second stage bootloader into DDR from which it will be executed from. If you want to make this system secure, at this moment we have a problem, because we cannot guarantee the integrity and confidentiality of the contents stored in the external flash. So an attacker can modify these contents and actually own the box. So we need a mechanism to actually to provide this assurance, and this is typically referred to as secure boot. So secure boot provides assurance on the integrity and confidentiality of the code in external flash, and it's typically very similar to the chain of trust that you can find in your browser, which is based on PKI. So we have there's one difference though, is that typically a secure boot implementation is based on a single root of trust, which is typically composed of an immutable piece of code, in this case the ROM code, and an immutable public key, which in this case the public key, which is also stored in the ROM code. And the combination of this code and key is used to load the external flash stage and authenticate this before executing. A more complex variant is there, which also provides confidentiality to the code. And this means that there should be a symmetric key available to the ROM code, which can decrypt the payload before it starts executing it. One thing to realize is that typically secure boot is consisting of multiple stages. For example, if we look at this ARM trusted firmware reference implementation, we see that there's multiple stages executed consecutively. And the key takeaway here is that these stages are typically run under a different privilege level. The early stages are running under a higher privilege level. So the idea here is the earlier you break into the secure boot chain, the higher privilege an attacker will have. But this makes you think, why do you resort to such a complicated and probably expensive hardware attack if there's logical vulnerabilities? And this is very true. So during the years, we've seen numerous early boot stage vulnerabilities for the iPhone, for example, and more recently, a specific secure boot bypass leveraging a vulnerability in the boot ROM code was used to bypass secure boot. However, the early boot stages that are running under the highest privilege level are typically consisting of a small code base. So that means that there is a small logical attack surface. And this probably means that there are implementations that are not logically flawed. And especially when these implementations are running in a hostile environment and the vendors proactively resolve the issues that we identify. So in such situations, when the implementations are not logically flawed and we want to break in early into the secure boot, we need another type of attack. And such an attack is fault injection. However, there's a few drawbacks to fault injection. Typically, fault injection is invasive. We need to make modifications to the target. Also, performing fault injection remotely is typically not doable, so we need physical access to the device. We really need to get our hands dirty and put cables on the device. And typically, compared to a logical vulnerability to exploit, it's more expensive. You need different type of skills, and you need specific tooling. However, there are significant advantages. We do not rely on a logical vulnerability. The code can be perfectly fine, and Albert will show later, this can be already enough to enable us to perform fault injection. And nowadays, today's technology is typically not robust against fault injection, meaning that the root cause, so the fault injection itself, is not actually mitigated. And it becomes especially interesting when during boot there's assets available that are not accessible after boot. So typical assets you can think of, for example, the boot code itself can be an asset. Typically, these stages are encrypted or maybe not even available after boot. And also, the keys decrypting these stages may be an asset. So if you can get to these keys, you can decrypt the stages that are executed during boot. Also, certain hardware, possibly for used to decrypt these stages, might also not be accessible anymore after boot. So what we can do, if we break in during boot, we can actually access these engines. And then even though the keys are not exposed, we can use them either as an oracle or we can perform other types of attacks, such as side-channel analyzes. I would like to take a brief moment to perform some fault injection to set the stage. Recently, a very nice video got posted where the open source hardware, the source of the chip whisper was used in order to perform fault injection. And it works very well. However, at risk here, we use our in-house tooling, which is commercially available and very easy to use. And actually, the setup you see here on the screen is the exact same setup that I have right in front of me. So we have a workstation that communicates with our glitcher, and it also communicates with the target. And this glitcher allows us to put an arbitrary voltage into the target, being the ARM core that is used on this board, and it allows us to inject glitches at arbitrary moments in time. And whenever the target actually gets into an erroneous state, we can reset the board using a relay which switches the external power supply to the board. And one thing to realize here is that the target that we are using is a Digiland Zybo board, which is based around a system on chip from Xilinx. And actually, within this chip, there's an ARM Cortex A9 core, which will be the target of this demonstration. So what we see here is a tool that... one moment. So in practice, the setup looks more like this. A lot of cables everywhere. So this is actually the setup we used during the preparation. And one of the things we do in order to determine if the robustness of the target is valid or not, we actually perform a characterization step. And typically what we do, we run a very simple program that just initializes a counter to zero, execute a stream of add instructions. And then the hypothesis is if our glitch is successful, the counter value will change. So we affect the sum of the add instructions. And one thing to realize here is that we have full control over the target, which is typically not the case for secure boot, but for this characterization step, it is certainly possible. So we can get different types of responses back from this test program. So when we glitch not too hard, and that means that there will be no change in the behavior, then we'll get the expected counter value back, which is in this case 10,000. When we glitch too hard, we will actually not send the counter value back at all. The program either crashes or the board is reset. So we will classify these as mute, and we color them yellow. But if we glitch with exact the right strength, actually the counter value will change. And that means that some of the add instructions, the intended behavior changed. And we classify these as success. And one thing to realize is that if you glitch too hard too often, it may of course happen that you actually damage the target permanently and you need to swap the sample and continue glitching on another device. So in order to set the stage for the demonstration, what we are doing from the target is we set a specific signal that tells us the exact moment in time where the add instructions start targeting. So that means that we exactly know in time where these add instructions are being executed. And we actually randomize the moment we glitch exactly in this window. So we do not glitch outside of the stream of add instructions. We randomize the glitch voltage. So we do not know exactly how deep the dip has to be for volt injection. So we're randomizing this between the voltage we power the device and -2. And also the length of the dip. We do not know exactly what the width will be for this particular target. So also we'll randomize that. So what we see here is our tool that allows us to plot the different responses on the screen. So what we see here is we see different dots appearing that are according to the color that we set. So what we see here is that there is a specific area is turning yellow. So the combination of the glitch duration, so the glitch length, which is on the y-axis, and the absolute glitch VCC, so the amplitude of the dip, is too strong and the target will mute or reset. And there's also a distinctive area where the experiments are green. And at these locations, the combination between those two glitch parameters are actually causing no change in the behavior at all. So the glitch is not strong enough. However, between those two areas, you see red dots appear. And that means that at those locations, the combination of the glitch parameters are exactly right. We change the behavior of the target. So what we establish now is that the setup we made and the target modifications that we had to make to the target are effective and allow us to perform fault injection. And actually that results in the target not being robust against fault injection. And this is actually the primitive you need to bypass secure boot using fault injection. And this is what my colleague Albert will detail, and I will give him the word.
Hi. So Nick just gave us an introduction on fault injection and secure boot, and a little bit about parameter variation for fault injection. Let's now actually move on to actually bypassing secure boot. And we're going to first talk a little bit about the classic, so some classic bypasses. Then we're going to talk about mitigations actually vendors are already using. And then we'll talk about some advanced bypasses, which can hopefully actually get past these mitigations. So if you have a secure boot implementation, at the end of the day, you're going to have to compare a computed hash with either a stored hash or a decrypted hash. And you're probably going to do that using something along the lines of memcompare. So this is an example from the embed TLS project. And here we see that there is a memory compare with the computed hash against the decrypted hash. And if these are the same, the device boots, and otherwise an error is returned. So when an attacker modifies the flash contents, these the computed hash will no longer match the decrypted hash and will return an error. So let's have a look at the disassembly of that function. So here is the disassembly of that function. And what we see is that there is a memory compare. The arguments are being set up above it. And if the comparison fails, we return an error. And otherwise, we continue booting. So what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to think for a second. And I'd like you to use the fault model given by my colleague, which was instruction corruption. And I'd like to think of a number of places where we can actually introduce a fault and actually completely bypass this check. So the first bypass we have is actually if we manage to skip both the move and the call to memcompare, we'll actually be able to boot even if our hashes don't match. We can also think about skipping the compare branch not zero instruction. And in this case, we'll fall through and we'll also start to boot. And there are also a number of other examples. So there are actually multiple locations where we can bypass this check with a single fault. So if we take a little step back and actually look at the code that was calling that function snippet, in this case, embed TLS PK verify, we can actually also think of the type of faults we would need to inject here. So in this case, embed TLS verify checks. And if it fails, we don't boot, and otherwise we boot. So we can actually probably insert the same kind of faults here. And the point is that bypasses can happen on all levels. They can happen inside functions, inside their calling functions, and inside their calling functions. So what happens when signature verification fails? What are we going to do? Well, a classic answer was to just enter an infinite loop. So here we have the same code, but instead of not booting, we have a while one. So if we look at the disassembly of that function, what we see is we have our embed TLS PK verify function. And if it succeeds, we continue booting. And otherwise, we enter an infinite loop. Now, for an attacker, this is very, very nice. Because what it means is that if you manage to inject a fault into any iteration of this infinite loop, we'll actually fall through and actually continue booting. And this is very nice because it means timing is not an issue. We've actually just removed one of the parameters we need to search. So this is actually a classic smart card attack. And it's probably better to reset or wipe keys in such a situation. So our final classic bypass is the secure boot enable. So typically, secure boot is often enabled or disabled based on a bit on a field in OTP, in one-time programmable memory. So this means that when people are developing for the board, secure boot can be disabled. They can have no problem developing. And then in the field, this bit can be enabled. So typically, just after the CPU comes out of reset, something like the following will be run. A value will be read from OTP. And then depending on that value, we'll either turn on integrity checking and decryption, or otherwise, we'll completely disable it. So this actually sounds like a prime example for some fault injection. So, of course, vendors are already aware of these classic bypasses, and they have some mitigations. And these mitigations and countermeasures are actually classically from the smart card world. And they can be categorized into two groups. We have the hardware countermeasures and the software countermeasures. And the goal of the hardware countermeasures is actually to detect the glitch while it's being injected, or perhaps a fault when it has already occurred. On the other hand, the software countermeasures can be used to lower the probability of a successful fault. So if you imagine that the probability of bypassing a single check is a certain value, bypassing two checks in succession is going to be a lot less likely. Yep. However, they don't really address the root cause of a fault. They cannot really address the fact that, you know, they can't detect that the target is being glitched. So they can lower the probability of a successful bypass, but they cannot completely rule it out. So I'd like to take a moment and talk to you about compiler optimizations, because this is something we've seen repeatedly going wrong. So ROM memory size is typically limited, and that is because ROM directly goes into your die. So compiler optimizations are used to decrease the code size. However, the compiler actually optimizes out intended code. And especially when you're talking about fault injection countermeasures, this can be an issue. So here we have a very simple example of a double check. We have a password, and instead of comparing it only once, we compare it twice. So we realized our previous example had a point where we can detect one fault, and that's probably going to be a lot less likely now. So let's have a look at the disassembly when we compile this. So this is compiled without optimizations, and we see that there is actually two mem compares. Excellent. So we turn on optimizations, and what do we see? We see that there is only a single memory compare. Our carefully crafted fault injection countermeasure has just been removed. So there are probably some best practices. You have to realize your compiler is smarter than you. And you can use volatile to prevent compiler problems. And it's probably also a good idea to read your compiler output before you send it off to go into a $500,000 tape out. And we don't recommend you read it all, just the very security sensitive areas. So even if you use volatile, things can go wrong. So we have another example. We're going to read a value from OTP. We've made that point of volatile, and then we read from it twice. And then if both of these values are checked correctly, we'll turn off secure boot, and otherwise we'll enable it. So let's have a look at some disassembly here. And what we actually see is that actually there are two loads from that pointer. However, we only have a single point where the pointer is set up. So even here, a single fault could bypass secure boot. Okay, so I just talked about some classic bypasses and their mitigations. However, the attack surface is larger. So the bypasses I'm now going to talk about have actually all been performed on multiple targets, and they were successful. So our advanced attacks are actually something called combined attacks. And the idea is basically to introduce a logical vulnerability using fault injection. It's basically build your own buffer overflow. And for our first bypass, we're going to take an easy approach, and we're going to try and change the size arguments for memory compare. Memcopy. So before our corruption, we're going to try and copy 1,000 hex, and we're going to introduce a fault, and hopefully we're going to copy a lot more. So this is nice because it actually also works when dedicated hardware is used. So for instance, if DMA engines are used, this is actually also applicable because we're actually trying to change the parameters to this function. So here is the embedded system my colleague Nick explained in the beginning, and the BL1.1 will be loaded to SRAM, and the BL1.2 will be loaded to DDR. However, there is something we didn't mention. The SRAM also contains the stack. So I think everyone can see where this is going. So this is the code that we're going to be copying with, and we see the arguments being set up, followed by the memcopy itself. So we prepare a special image in Flash. We have some code followed by a lot of pointers to the buffer in SRAM. And as the device starts booting, as it's turned on, we'll introduce a fault. And hopefully what will happen is we'll glitch that size parameter and too much data will be copied in. So hopefully our code will be copied in, followed by a lot of these pointers. Hopefully these pointers will overwrite the stack, and then when the functions return, one of these pointers will be picked up, popped up, and will go into the PC register. And this will cause the CPU to jump directly to the code. And that means we've actually bypassed both the authentication and the decryption of the image. So our second combined attack exploits a characteristic of the ARM32 instruction set. And that characteristic is that the PC register, the program counter, is directly accessible by most instructions. So normally, if you want to copy memory around on an ARM system, you use the LDR and the SDR instructions. But there is a faster way, and that's using the LDM family of instructions. So what we see here is we have an LDM instruction, and we're going to copy from the pointer R1, and we're going to copy into the registers R3 through R10. And then we're going to take the same registers and store them in the pointer R0. And in this way, each loop iteration will copy 32 bytes. So if we now introduce a fault, we can actually add PC to the destination operands. And for this, we actually only need to change one bit. If we change that specific bit, the PC register will be added to the operand and will actually read an extra value from the pointer R1, and we'll move that value directly into the program counter. So variations of this attack are also possible in other architectures. However, they're more dependent on the surrounding code. So let's have a look how we could conduct such an attack. So we actually have exactly the same setup as before. We have our code and our pointers in Flash. And then instead of targeting the parameter setup, we're going to glitch somewhere else. And we're going to try and introduce a fault into the memcopy. So when the device boots up, we're going to wait until it has copied in our code. And as it's copying our pointers, we'll introduce a fault. And hopefully, this will cause one of these pointers to directly end up in the program counter, and thus executing our code. The nice thing here is that we've actually not only bypassed secure boot, but we've able to bypass fault injection countermeasures in software as well. So our final combined attack, and our personal favorite, is the wild jungle jump. And the basic idea is to start glitching after the device has started copying the data from Flash, but before that data is either decrypted or the signature verification has failed. And the idea is that there are lots of magic pointers around in the system which point close to our code. And we hope that one of these pointers basically ends up in the PC register. And we can get these magic pointers from anywhere. We can get them from the stack when a fault causes the stack to be misaligned, or we can get them from registers, or we can get them from other locations in memory. And the more magic pointers are around in the system, the higher the probability of success. So to summarize our combined attacks a bit, they allow a bypass of both the authentication and the decryption of secure boot images. Typically, there's actually a little software exploitation during mitigation during boot. So typically in these early stages, we don't see any stack cookies, we don't see any ASLR. And finally, one of the bypasses we showed is can also bypass fault injection mitigations, which are implemented in software. However, there are a number of practicalities.
Yeah, so we've seen a nice overview of different bypasses, but when actually you want to apply these in practice, there are indeed some practicalities which we need to overcome. I would like to address these practicalities based on a demo implementation of a secure boot. And this is actually the implementation that's laying here in front of us. So as you can see already, there's a significant thing missing here is that the ROM does not authenticate stage one. But the stage we're focusing on is actually stage one, which is in this case U-boot. And that will actually load and authenticate stage two. And one thing to realize for this demo is that this stage two is actually printing a string during boot. And this string is "Hello Black Hat Europe 2016. And in order to actually modify this image and thereby invalidating the signature, we change this string directly in the binary to "Hello Black Hat Europe 2017. Obviously wrong. And the idea here is that stage one will enter an infinite loop the moment it actually detects the signature is invalid. So the first problem we need to overcome is when to glitch. For example, we've seen during the characterization, so the demo we showed earlier, we could set up a signal that would tell us exactly the moment where the add instructions start executing. However, when you target secure boot, you don't have this luxury. You have no control over the system. So the only reference point you have is the moment you press the reset button, because the secure boot implementation will only execute after power on reset. So every time you reset, that will be your reference point. However, we can use side channels in order to give us more information where the moment would be where we want to inject our glitch. So in this case, it can be the moment the signature is being validated, or the moment where the invalidness is detected, or when the unrolled loop is executing. And what we can do is, in order to do this efficiently, we can actually compare the behavior in these side channels between a valid image and an invalid image. So for example, the first side channel we can actually use is the power on reset signal itself. So this is actually the line that will take the chip out of reset and then the secure boot will start executing. Well, as you can imagine, there's no significant difference between the two, because the power on reset moment is the same, whether the signature is valid or not. And it means that our attack window, so where we have to guess the moment in time where we have to glitch, is actually spread across the entire trace, which is in this case 400 milliseconds. However, there's other side channels, such as the flash activity. And what we see here is that there's three distinctive moments in time where the flash is being accessed. So for the valid image, there's three flash activities, 1, 2, and 3. And for the invalid image, there's only 2 flash activities. And this is logical because we actually invalidated the signature of the second flash activity. That is the second stage of the boot chain. And what this means is that we already decreased the attack window from 400 milliseconds to a smaller window, because we know that the authentication has to happen after the image is being loaded, but before the next image is being loaded. And in this case, for this particular implementation, this is roughly 10 milliseconds. So remember this picture. One thing that we did not talk about is this little probe that's on top of the chip. This is actually a passive probe, which allows us to measure the electromagnetic emissions originating from the chip. And these are a derivative of the power consumption. So because the valid image and the invalid image do something different during boot, there will be a difference there. So what we see here is the two measurements we've taken for the valid and the invalid image. And we see that there's a significant difference between the two. When we zoom in more, we actually see that this difference is much more significant than we earlier saw, because we see that at that moment in time, the unrolled loop will be entered from the invalid image. And we know this because an unrolled loop will give a very flat power profile. And that's exactly what you see there. So we actually detected the exact moment where the code is actually detecting the signature is invalid and starts deviating from the intended code path with a valid image. If we zoom in more, we identify another problem. We see that the moment in time where the chip starts detecting the invalidness of the signature happens in different moments in time. And this actually means that if we would glitch for one experiment at the right moment, that all for all the subsequent experiments, we will glitch not at the right moment in time. And the jitter after power and reset is roughly, for this particular moment, 150 microseconds. And that means we need to overcome this in order to provide a stable glitch at always at the right moment in time. So the real problem is that the reference point we are currently using is the power on reset moment, which happens roughly 300 milliseconds before. So we need to use a signal that is closer to the moment we want to glitch in order to overcome the jitter introduced during boot. But we know what signal we can use because we looked already at the flash activity, and we know actually that flash activity 2 is just before the signature is being verified. So we can actually use that signal to time our glitch in a more efficient manner. So then if we take the same power profile and we zoom in again on the power measurement, we see actually that the moment in time where the glitch, or where the signature is being found to be invalid, is now happening always at the same moment in time. So that means that if we inject our glitch for experiment 1 at the right moment, for all subsequent experiments, it will be at the right moment, effectively bypassing all the jitter. And one thing to realize is that jitter can be inherent to the system, but it can also be a countermeasure. For example, random delays during boot, which actually introduce this jitter in order to make it more complex to perform a successful attack. And doing this, we bypass all the random delays implemented prior to the flash activity 2. I would like to give another demo, and this is really a demo bypassing secure boot. And what we are going to do during this demo is not target the moment where the glitch is found to be invalid, but the moment where the endless loop is executing. Because this allows us to take one of the glitch parameters out of the equation. Because as Albert already explained, timing is not an issue. It does not matter when we actually glitch this endless loop, as long as we glitch it. What the characterization of the target showed, so the previous demo, is that there's a relationship between the glitch length and the amplitude of the dip of the glitch. So we also can fix this parameter, because across the entire search space that we use for the characterization, the relation is roughly the same. So it takes another parameter out of the search space. And then the only thing we will actually randomize is the glitch length. So without going in too much detail, the setup that we have lying here in front of us is exactly this setup. And if you would like more information, please come after the talk to us. We will have some time where we can discuss this in more detail. And I will switch now back over to the other laptop in order to run the demo. So first of all, I'd like to explain a little bit what you're seeing here. So the topmost window is our oscilloscope, and this actually shows in the blue signal it shows the reset line. So the moment that blue signal goes up, the chip comes out of reset, and then the red signal is actually the flash activity that we're talking about, and you see a lot of stuff happening there. But for most experiments, what you actually see is that there's two flash activities: the very big one, which is U-boot, and the smaller one out just after it, which is the second stage we invalidated. The bottom of the screen is our tool that actually communicates with our glitcher and also communicates with the target. And what you see there is, for most experiments, it is actually green. And this means that only U-boot prints the boot string, and the subsequent stage that we invalidated is not executed. However, for some experiments, you will notice that the colors become different, and the colors are given based on the output. So, for example, what you see here is that other stuff is being printed. This one is not that. So it is glitching in the end, so some things are not that interesting always, because arbitrary things can happen. It's sometimes hard to predict what happens. So what we are waiting for now is a successful glitch. And then, but of course, what you have to realize, fault injection is probability. So we can be very unlucky and not get a glitch. So what we see here now is that indeed our glitch actually printed the invalidated string. So that means that we actually bypass secure boot in that fashion. And one thing to realize is that this is also reflected in the oscilloscope. So what you see here is actually that the third flash activity that only happens when you boot stage 2 is actually visible in the screen. So that means that actually we successfully bypass secure boot. And we will leave this experiment run for a little bit. And for the people that are interested, we can also run this experiment outside of the room after the talk to talk a little bit more in detail what's going on in the tool and in the target. And I would like to take some time to lay out a few best practices for implementers of secure boot. So when you implement secure boot, you really want to make sure you minimize the attack surface. So the more, for example, from a logical vulnerability point of view, it's very important that you authenticate all code and data. And this is typically what's being done. However, one thing to realize is that other structures, for example, headers or images describing how the flash is laid out, they're also part of this particular attack surface. Next, we really want to make sure that we limit the functionality present in ROM. And also, this is logical also from a logical vulnerability point of view, but also for fault injection, the more code that is exposed to an attacker, the more probability or the more chances you have to bypass secure boot. For example, Albert laid out that the easiest points in order to bypass secure boot are the points where you can actually, by injecting a single fault, bypass secure boot. And the more code that's exposed, the more of those points will likely be there. Also, it's important to disable memory when it's not required. And this can be on different levels. For example, you can disable execution until the image is actually authenticated. And some of the attacks that Albert actually explained, they rely on the fact that we can jump to our code prior to the authentication or decryption. And by actually not allowing you to execute until the image is actually authenticated, it will become way more complex to actually implement a successful attack. Then you really want to lower the probability. For example, you want to implement fault injection countermeasures. And as Albert already explained, you can implement these countermeasures both in software and hardware. And the nice thing typically about these countermeasures is that they work together. So they stack upon each other. So the more you implement, if you do this efficiently, the better it gets. And then also, we've seen that it's very effective to combine logical exploitation and fault injection. So if you implement software countermeasures against software exploitation, then it becomes more complex to perform such attacks. And one thing to take home is that it's really difficult to determine what the robustness of a target is based on a paper study or based on a design review only. Because using fault injection, behavior can occur within the target, which you cannot predict beforehand. So you really need to start doing the fault injection on a particular target in order to determine what the robustness is. It can look very sound on paper, but in practice, it might be very easy to actually bypass the authentication of the secure boot. And then I would like to finalize with a few statements. So what we've seen over the last 5 years that today's technology is really not robust against fault injection. There's not too many targets that actually prevent you from injecting glitches themselves. So the root cause is almost always applicable. And then they rely on other things, such as software vulnerabilities, in order to lower the probability for a successful attack. But that is not the way to go. These hardware countermeasures, so whenever you actually rely on secure boot, so you know that during secure boot, certain things are accessible, or the system that gets initialized during boot relies on the security of secure boot, then you really need to consider fault risks. And these fault risks can only efficiently be mitigated using hardware countermeasures. So as Albert explained, software countermeasures help, but they do not prevent the threat itself. And then as a last point, it's really important to start testing the implementations. And like already stressed before, you cannot do this based on the paper study or the design review itself. Thank you very much. I hope you liked it. This was it. And like I said before, we will be here for a little while longer if you're interested in what this setup is and what it's composed of. Thank you.